most functions that we encounter are real-valued functions. So functions from an interval in R to the real number. So for example, take the following function. This function f has I equal to 0 plus infinity. So the interval I starts in 0 all the way to plus infinity. This function f is also a non-decreasing function. So if we take small x and small y here, so y is larger than x, then we can go to the function values fx and fy. And we see that if y is larger than x, then fy is also larger than fx. So such a function is called a non-decreasing function. If a function is non-decreasing or non-increasing, then we call it a monotone function. Consider the following function. So this is the function f, and this function is not monotone because sometimes it's going up and sometimes it's going down. So it's never always non-decreasing or never always non-increasing. But this function is what we call a continuous function. So why it is continuous? Take some x here. Its function value fx is here. Then you see that if you take a y here and you let y move closer and close to x, then the function value fy will also get closer and closer to fx. And you can take a y that is larger than x, you can take a z which is smaller than x. If you have z going to x, then again you will see that the function value in z is going towards the function value in x. That's an example of a continuous function. Consider now the following function. This function is not a continuous function. Why is that? So if we take x here, then you see that if I take a z here, if I now let z go towards x, then the function value fz will go to this function value, whereas the function value in x is here. So we can never get z close enough to x such that fz is getting very close to fx. And in the limit, it should be equal to fx because we have a jump here. However, if you take y, if I take y here, then you see if I let y move closer and closer to x, then the function value of y gets closer and closer to the function value of x. So this function is not continuous. It has a discontinuity in x, but this function is what we call right continuous. Because if I come from the right, my function value of y is getting closer and closer to the function value of x. However, if I come from the left, I can never get really close to the function value in x. It's a right continuous function, but it's not left continuous. An example of a left continuous function is the following function. It's this function. So if you now take x here, then the function value of x is here. And if I now take z somewhere here, you see that the function value in z is getting closer and closer to the function value of x when z is approaching x. So this function here is left continuous. And you see the difference between right and left continuity is in where you put the function value. Is it right before the jump or right after the jump? In this course, we will use probability theory a lot. So I hope that you get some basic knowledge on probability theory. And here I will give you a very brief overview of the most important concepts in probability theory. So what do we have? We start with a probability space. So a probability space is used to model a random experiment. So what is a random experiment? It's an experiment where you do not know what will be the outcome, the realization of the experiment. For example, if you toss a coin, you don't know if you get head or tail. Or if you throw a dice, you don't know what number you will get. If you invest your money in stocks, you don't know if you will lose money or if you will gain money. So these are all random experiments. And a probability space is capturing all the things we do know from our random experiment. So in a random experiment, we don't know what will be the exact outcome, but we know something. For example, we know the set omega, the set with all possible realizations. So for example, if you throw a dice, you know that you will get 1, 2, 3, all the way to 6. You don't know exactly which of these 6 numbers you get, but you know it's one of these 6. It can never be 7, it can never be 8. What else do we have? We have this F, which is what we call a set of events, and is basically a collection of subsets of our universe omega. For example, an event could be the event that you throw an even number when you throw a dice, or the event that you throw something bigger than 3, or something smaller than 5, and so on. So these are events, things that can happen with our random experiment. We don't know if a certain event will occur, but we can assess the likelihood that it will happen. And that's where the probability measure P comes into play. So the P is just a function. It's a function from the set F with events, the things that can happen, to a probability, a number in 0, 1. So you have events that are very likely to happen, you have events that are less likely to happen. For example, if you look at throwing a dice, you can investigate what's the probability that I will throw 3, 4, or 5. There's an event in F. With the probability measure P, you can assess the probability that that will happen. Give me a simple example of a random experiment and its probability space. So the example is throwing a dice. So what's the universe? So what are the possible outcomes you can get? It's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 6. So you know that if you throw the dice, you get one of these numbers. You can never get 0, never get 7, or anything larger. What is the F? The set of events. You have the event that you throw 1. So just the set only containing 1 is in my F. You have the set only containing 2 is also in your F, because that's the event where you just throw 2, and so on. But you also have the event 1, 2, 3, meaning the event where you throw a dice and you get something smaller or equal to 3. Or you have the event 4, 5, 6. It's the event where you get something larger than 3, and so on. So all possible subsets of the omega are in the set F. Then the probability space, probability measure P, maps each event into a probability. For example, we can look at the probability of getting 1, 2, or 3. So the probability that you throw a dice and you get something smaller or equal to 3. This probability is of course equal to 1/2 if you have a fair dice. Similarly, you can look at the probability that you get 4, 5, or 6, so that you get something larger than 3 is also equal to 1/2. And you can determine the probability of each of the events. The probability of getting just 1 is equal to 1/6. The probability of getting 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 6 is of course equal to 1. So the probability that you get 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 6 is of course equal to the probability that you get something from the set omega, your universe, and that's always equal to 1. A probability space, the one for example that we have here, is used to describe the possible outcomes and the probabilities of a random experiment. For example, on the previous slide, we explained that if you throw a dice, the universe omega of the probability space is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. So now assume that you have the random experiment where you throw a dice, but if you throw 1, 2, or 3, you will lose 1 euro. If you throw 4, 5, 6, you will gain 1 euro. If you now play this random experiment, of course you are interested in what is the outcome of the random experiment, but you are even more interested, how much money do I get? You do not really care if you throw 1 or 3, because in both cases you will end up with a loss of $1. And you prefer to have either 4, 5, or 6, because that will give you a profit of $1. And that's where we use a random variable. For example, I can use the random variable x to describe the profit and loss that I get when I play this random experiment. So x is a function. It's a function from the universe. So one of these elements in the universe will occur when I play the random experiment. And the random variable x will map each of the outcomes into a real number r. For example, in our case, this represents the profit or loss that I get. So in that case, it means that, for example, x1, so the random variable when we throw 1, is equal to minus 1. Because if I throw 1, then I will lose $1. And also x2 and also x applied in 3 will give you minus 1. Whereas x4 and x5 and x6 will give you plus 1. Because if you throw 4, 5, 6, the random variable x will tell you, in this case, you will earn 1 euro. So we have the random experiment and a probability space to describe the possible outcomes of a random experiment. The random variable x describes a single aspect of each of the possible outcomes omega of my random experiment. The universe omega is a set with all the possible outcomes of some random experiment. So in omega we have all the possible outcomes, which I call omega 1, omega 2, omega 3, and so on. Everything that can happen when we play our random experiment. Then we have a random variable x, which is a function that maps each of the elements in that set omega to the real numbers. For example, we can interpret these real numbers as profits and losses. All right, so assume that I take a subset of this set R. For example, this is what I call the set I. So now I can move in the opposite direction. I can say what elements in the universe omega will result in a value for the random variable x that belongs to this set I. For example, assume that we have omega 4, omega 5, omega 6, that all these elements are mapped into values that lie in the set I. In that case, I call this inverse x minus 1 I. I call this omega 4, omega 5, omega 6. And so this is just the example for this particular case that I draw here. In general, we say that x minus 1 I contains all the elements omega that are in the universe, for which we have that if omega happens and I apply the random variable x on omega, so x omega, this should be an element in I. This is what we call the set x minus 1 I. And what we assume is that this set x minus 1 I belongs to F, the set of all the events. Why do we need this assumption? We need this assumption because if you remember about the probability space, we had there that there is a universe omega, there is a set of events f, and there is a probability measure p. And this probability measure p can attach probabilities to each event in the set f. So if we have that x minus 1 I, so the elements in omega that are mapped onto the set I, if this set belongs to f, we can determine the probability x minus 1 I, which you can think of as a probability that my random variable x takes a value in I. Because if my random variable x needs to take a value in I need to realize omegas in the universe that will be mapped into I using the random variable. So in order to have this probability well defined, we need that x minus 1 I, this set, belongs to the set of events. And for us, we always assume that the random variable x that we encounter satisfies this condition. And in that case, we call x a measurable function. So far, we discussed probability spaces and we discussed random variables. So what we have is a probability space with a universe omega, a random variable that maps this universe into the real numbers, r, and assume that, like we had in the example with the dice drawing, assume that x represents your income. So if x is positive, you gain money. If x is negative, you're losing money. Then we are mostly concerned about this part, about the outcomes of the random variable x. We are not so much interested in what is the underlying probability space. So what do I mean with this? So let me explain. Assume that you say x is my income and I'm looking for the probability that x is zero or strictly positive, meaning I'm looking at the events where I do not lose money. And I want to use the probability measure p. I want to write what's the probability that I am not losing money. So if we look at all the outcomes of x that correspond with this event, we can have zero or something positive. So call this the set B. Then the set B is starting in zero, going all the way to plus infinity. So I'm looking for the probability that my random variable x takes a value in B. However, there's a problem with this statement. If I look at the probability measure P, the probability measure P can only take the probability of an event. And remember, when we had a probability space, an event was an element out of the set F, and an event is a collection of elements from the universe. So for example, if I take omega 1, omega 2, omega 3, omega 4, omega 5, and omega 6, like we had in the dice drawing game, I can take, for example, all these events, I can take the probability of getting omega 4, omega 5, omega 6. That I can do. But here, I'm looking at a probability of a subset of R, and the probability measure P is not defined for that subset. That's why I use this set x minus 1b that we defined on the previous slide. Because x minus 1b are all the elements of the universe that are mapped into the set B. Because I assume that x is a measurable function, this thing here belongs to f, meaning it's a collection of elements of the universe, and now I can safely apply the probability measure p on this set. So what I want to do is I want to calculate this probability. I want to write down this probability, the probability that x is larger or equal than zero. Intuitively, we know what we mean. Mathematically, we are calculating this thing here. So in the book and in the course, you will see these statements all the time. But know that what we actually mean are statements based on the underlying probability space. And here you see the relation. If we have a random variable x, then we can link to this random variable the cumulative distribution function, which we denote by fx. And the cumulative distribution function is defined as the probability that the random variable x is smaller or equal than some value small x. If you want to calculate this probability that x belongs to some interval b, once you know the cumulative distribution function for any value of x, you can calculate this probability, whatever b is. So that's why the cumulative distribution function is really important when you want to understand a random variable. Because we take this inequality, your function is non-decreasing. And because we do not take the strict inequality but smaller or equal, because of the equality, it's a right continuous function. So for example, a distribution function is a function that looks like this. So of course, we have probabilities, so it's somewhere between 0 and 1. It is non-decreasing, and it always starts in 0 and ends in 1. In this case, the function fx is continuous and is always differentiable. However, we can look at another situation where the distribution function makes a jump. So assume that the jump occurs in this value x. So now we have that the function value in x is here. We have a jump, but because we have the equality in the definition of the distribution function, the CDF has to be right continuous. So if you take a jump, we always need that the function value is on the right side. Otherwise, we do not have a right continuous distribution function. All right. This value here, so the function value right before you have the jump, it's what we call fx x minus. So now we have that the jump size, delta x, is as follows. It's the distribution function in x minus the distribution, the value of the distribution function right before you are in x. So that's fx x minus. This is the probability, so this distribution function is the probability that x is smaller or equal than x. The only difference with x minus is that we do not include x. So this is the probability that x is strictly smaller than x. So then you find that if we have a jump, then the size of the jump is exactly the probability that x takes the value x. So if we have a distribution function that is continuous in x, so for example here, if I put x here, you see that the distribution function in this example in x is continuous, meaning that fx of x is equal to fx x minus, meaning that the probability that the random variable x is exactly equal to x is zero in this case. So for continuous distribution function, you always have that the probability that x takes a specific value is zero. If you have a discrete distribution function that makes a jump, then we have a probability mass in a certain value. For example, if you take a game where you throw a dice, then you have jumps in 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, because you have a strictly positive probability that you take the value 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 6. Consider the following distribution function. It's a distribution function that has a jump here, but is continuous in all other points. So this is the function fx, and assume that the jump is here in the point A. Then we're looking for d f x of x. Assume first that x is equal to a. So we are looking at the jump of the distribution function. In this case, we define d f x because the d here stands for a difference. We can define this as delta a. It's the jump size the jump size in A. However, if we have a value x that is different from A, for example, take x here, in this case, delta x is equal to 0. That's what we showed on the previous slide. But then we assume that if we have a point on the distribution function where the distribution function is continuous, we also assume that it is differentiable. That we can look for fx of x, where fx of x, small f, is the derivative in the distribution function. So we assume that the distribution function has a jump or is continuous, and then it's also differentiable. In that case, we define dfx of x as the derivative, small f, dx. And then, with this definition of dfx, we can define the expectation of g of x. So the expectation of a function g applied on the random variable x. Because the random variable takes values in I, so we assume that x goes from the universe to I, we integrate over all possible values of the random variable. Each of these values is transformed by the function g, and then we weight each of the outcomes by this dfx, which is now defined in this way. And if you have a look, then you can think of dfx x as the probability that the random variable x takes the value small x. What we assume is that the expectation of x, which is expectation x, that this expectation is always finite. So on average, the random variable x takes on a finite value. We don't want to work with random variables that have an expectation of plus infinity, because if we think of x as a loss, meaning that positive values of x are things that we have to pay, then if x has an expectation plus infinity, it means that we have a loss that on average is plus infinity, which means that it is something very dangerous. We don't want to work with such events. Consider a distribution function fx that has only a discrete part. So what do I mean with that? Assume that we have a distribution function that takes on the following form. It starts in 0 until it hits y1, and in y1 it makes a jump. And after that jump, it's constant again. Then it makes another jump in y2, and it is constant again. And then the last jump, say, in y3, and then it is constant again. And assume that in y3, the function jumps to 1, so it means that it remains at 1 for the rest of the time. So this is the distribution function. Then you see that this distribution function has a jump in y1, y2, y3. So here we have a jump size delta y1, delta y2, delta y3. But if we take a value different from y1, y2, y3, the function is horizontal, it's flat, meaning that f prime x, the derivative of the distribution function, which is small f in x, is equal to 0 if x is different from y1, y2, or y3. So if you then look at the expectation of gx, we have an integral over all possible values of our random variable. I take the function g, apply it on each of these values that the random variable can take, and I weight with this dfx of x. But this thing here, remember, it's either the jump size when there is a jump, or it is fx of x times dx when there is no jump. But all the horizontal parts will drop out because they have a density small f, which is equal to 0. So what you're left with is y1 delta y1 plus y2 delta y2 plus y3 delta y3. And because delta y1 is a probability that the random variable x is equal to y1, delta y2 is a probability that the random variable takes y2, and so on. So in that case, you see that the expectation just takes all the possible outcomes weighted by the probability of having that outcome. And in more general terms, the expectation, if you have only jumps in y, it's a summation, not an integral anymore. You take gy times the jump size.